one thing we might tell you that's not in her bio that's in your online class. And so we were trying to think of a fun thing, and she's like, fun thing? I don't have any time for any fun thing. Well, that's because she's also in the PhD program I'm in at Regent University. And that's how we met. We met in August when I went up there for one of my classes for my PhD, and she's finishing up her classes. She's in her last two classes this semester, so she'll finish in May. So we've had the opportunity to kind of bond over that and many other things. And I know that you're going to be blessed by her presentation. She'll be asking some questions. She also is helping set up an internship program for internal and external mobility for people moving up through the organization that she works with. I think you'll find that fascinating. Mm-hmm. She has opportunity to tell you about it. So please draw on her wealth of experience tonight as you speak with her. She is out of Charleston, South Carolina, and she moved there from the Bronx, New York. Yes. So had a little bit of culture shock, as one might can imagine, but decided she loves it.
Yeah.
So please welcome Crissy.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Everyone can hear me well?
Yes.
Okay, awesome. I probably don't even need this mic because I have a pretty big mouth typically, but this will work. I don't have to scream as much. So number one, first and foremost, congratulations. I mean, you guys deserve to be applauded because number one, you're here 7 o'clock in the evening, which shows quite a bit of discipline as well as dedication, and you look great. You guys look really great, so congratulations to you. And I know that you all are on a journey right now. Who believes that this experience here at this university is a part of your preparation to fulfill your calling, your mission in life? Oh yeah. Be open about this experience, the experiences that you gain here. It's a beautiful campus. Thank you again for the tour. Absolutely beautiful campus. You guys, do you realize how good you have it? This is fantastic, your own little secluded community. It's great. Let me ask you this. How many of you believe that you are being stretched in ways that you may not have been stretched before, as far as mentally, emotionally, spiritually, right? All right, I know, since you walked in the door, is that what you, I didn't mean to call you out. But I have kids, I have two small children, so I can hear things really well. So absolutely, and that is a part of the experience. This is your preparation, and so be open, continue to be open to the experiences that you gain here. One of the things that I wanted to share with you, because we know that no matter what, whether we have assignments due, discussion posts due, papers that are due, life continues to happen, right? And so there are challenges that we experience throughout our journey. And what do? We stay grounded within the word, right? And I just thought that I would share this with you. This is my desk, and I start my day out every day with reading the Bible, because I need that strong foundation to be able to navigate the complex business setting that I'm in, as well as just to be able to handle the everyday challenges that life brings. In addition, these are some little notes that I keep above my desk on a board, because I'm telling you, anything that you can do to help inspire you as you continue through your journey, go on ahead and do that. Whether that's placing little notes up of inspiration, because like we talked about over dinner, there will be times where you'd rather do anything else in the world but work on the paper. But then you remember that what you're doing is working towards something that's bigger than yourself, right? So whatever that God-given mission is for you, you keep that first, you keep God first, and then you remember to take self out of it. Typically when I am anxious about something, whether it's an assignment or meeting a deadline, is typically because I become stressed out about, oh goodness, how am I gonna do this? what am I going to, what do I have to maneuver around within my schedule to get this accomplished? And then I rest in God, I review my notes, I always write out prayers even before I start an assignment, so that way I can stay focused and remain grounded, and that helps me. That helps me quite a bit. So I just share that with you as a tip. These are some books that I have on my desk that I get to read in my downtime. I wanted to show you these books because I have a little pointer, that's right, okay. So super brain, because I want my brain to be super, I feel like I want a super brain, so I'm reading super brain. Also, you'll see neurotribes and preparing for life. So I talked about calling and I talked about mission and doing things that are bigger than yourself. So my why, the why reason that I'm in school right now and going through this PhD program is because what I'd like to do is to help marginalized groups such as individuals with disabilities be able to secure employment, whether that's working with universities and employers on how to teach individuals with disabilities. And so that's my why, how to employ individuals appropriately with disabilities. That's my why, and that's what keeps me going. So determine what your why is, and then use that as your foundation as well. So what we're talking about today is 21st century organizations. And organizational boundaries, they are blurring. And I'll use the example of even individuals with disabilities or diverse groups going into the organizations. Organizations are setting themselves up and preparing themselves for sustainability as these emergent groups come into the organization. We have the traditional versus your organic structures. So no longer are organizations the mechanistic where you are coming in doing the same thing on a daily basis. You're working to get that gold watch after being within an organization for 20 years. Those rigid structures and boundaries, they're becoming much more permeable. And so when you, how many of you work now? Okay, good deal. And so the work environment that you are getting into or you are in, hopefully that organization is blurring its boundaries, because without that, then the organization may not be able to sustain for emergent groups like yourself that's coming into the organization and just has different expectations of what that employer setting looks like. So if we look at the why do you think organizations are becoming more open and more fluid and taking into the consideration the needs of the emergent group of workers that are coming into the organization? Why do you think that? Sure, absolutely. Thank you. Yes. So I'll go on ahead and define it by this. So organizations want to be agile. They want to have agility in order to be able to adapt to the needs of its environment. So when an organization is fluid, meaning that they are able to change with the needs of the environment. Things are continuously changing within the organization, whether that's how learning and development is happening or talent management, different benefits and services of an organization. It's constant, it's continuous change. So that's what that's about. And it's because organizations want to be adaptable, they want to be able to meet the needs of, for example, millennials, which we'll talk about in a little bit. So that's a good question. And some of your influential forces, of course, you've probably heard of technology and globalization, heterogeneous or diverse workforce. And one of the biggest groups within this diverse workforce, millennials. Who's a millennial in here? I'm sure, yes, vast majority of you. So why don't you tell me, what are your some expectations when you enter into a work environment? What do you expect of your employer? whether that's regarding learning and development, benefits, services. Yes, sir.
Job growth potential.
Oh, absolutely. And then a few studies that I've reviewed, career development and growth is high up there as number one. And as a matter of fact, yep, continuous career development. Absolutely. What else? Yes. Oh, absolutely, yes, thank you. And I don't even think that one's up here. So the ones that I have up here, of course, it's not the only ones defining it, but you are absolutely right, autonomy, independence. Yes, provide me the guidelines, set the structure, but then give me the opportunity to go out and fulfill this and demonstrate it. So yes, absolutely, great. What else? Absolutely, respect. Who said that? Absolutely. And that, I think, falls in line with a participative leadership style with the manager. Millennials want to be heard, right? You want a voice in decision making. And so, absolutely, give me the opportunity to share what my ideas, my thoughts, and my opinions, I'd like to contribute to that decision making process. Anything else? Yes, sir.
Just to be valued.
Absolutely, absolutely. Valued, feelings of membership, purposefulness within the work that you do. These are all things that your 21st century organization are considering. So when you go into the work environment, I can guarantee you that leaders within those organizations have had these discussions. As a matter of fact, our leadership team has stated that we talk about millennials almost to nauseam, they stated, but it's so important to do that. We must learn about your needs, your expectations, because why is that? Why do you think that is?
Yes. Because they want you to work for them.
Absolutely. Absolutely. The reason why my position exists at South Carolina Federal Credit Union as a career services strategist is because my leadership team wanted ways to better acquire, engage, and retain specifically the millennial cohort. Anything that we do within South Carolina Federal Credit Union, it will benefit everyone. But the driving influential force behind that is the millennial group. So, and I use the word engage, and I want to make sure that everyone's clear on that. Engage is more than just satisfied. We want you to have a true intimate connection to what you're doing within the credit union. We want it to be more than just a job. And that's how employers are looking at it. We want there to be a commitment level so we get individuals to stay as long as possible. So these are the things that we talked about. Corporate social responsibility. We're a financial institution that's not only of communities that we serve, but we have an intimate connection with those communities. We're the oldest financial institution in South Carolina. And so we take that responsibility of helping our communities and to better our communities very seriously. Mm-hmm. Any questions on anything so far? Wish you guys know this because you're millennials. So that's good. You guys take such awesome notes. That's awesome. It's good. Okay. Oh, technology. You want information pretty much as soon as possible. Yeah, exactly. That's right. It's in your blood. Digital natives. Good deal. All right. So organizations that do not make their boundaries more permeable to the thoughts and ideas that entrants such as yourselves bring into the organization, who decide to remain rigid and closed and more task-oriented as opposed to relational, what do you think happens? How would you feel? Just think about how you would feel. Put yourself within an organization. And some of you may be within an organization that's like that. I don't know. But consider yourselves in an organization that doesn't really have any, that doesn't nurture relationships, lacks corporate social responsibility, more of an autocratic leadership style versus the participative, so you're not getting that respect that you want. How would that make you feel? Yes, ma'am.
Piece of a machine, just doing the same thing.
Yes, exactly, exactly. More of the task-oriented, not valued as much. Mm-hmm. Exactly right. Exactly right. Anyone else want to make a comment? Yes, sir.
Alien.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. No opportunities to build relationships. No opportunities. That would be hard. That would be, even for me, and I know you probably thought that I was a millennial. I know, but I'm actually not. I'm just one above, that's all. So I know it's surprising. I'll give you a second to get over that. Yes.
Did young people from previous generations not value these things? How are millennials specifically different than
people? Oh, that's a good question. That's a good question.
I feel like these are sort of universal to anyone who wants a good job. They want autonomy. They want
right.
They value social responsibility, operations, opportunities to participate in decision making. So.
Absolutely. So great question. What I want you to do is consider context as well. What influences generations is context, meaning what you grow up in as well. So yes, these are important things to everyone. Maybe traditionalists or individuals that have grown up within a different era, baby boomers, things like that. You consider those experiences, whether it's the depression or whether it's whatever stage of life that individual has been in, those influences shape what an individual's beliefs and values are. And so if it's a time around the depression, individuals that are working within organizations are happy to just go within an organization and to be able to fulfill the needs of that employer and be able to go home and do this and do that on a daily basis. So yes, those things that we discuss, they are valued by everyone. But one of the things that I always tell individuals to consider is the context of that generation. So what are some memorable moments within your generation? Yes, sir.
Right, but consider that the millennials came of age during the Great Recession. Mm-hmm.
Well, another good point. So what I think with the millennial generation, you have experienced your parents being laid off, you know? And so that has been a big element within shaping many of the beliefs and values that millennials have. And so going into the workforce and after seeing parents being laid off and just whether it's terrorism or other things going around that has occurred within your era, those are things that have shaped your thoughts and beliefs. And the United States is an individualistic society, but I do believe that millennials are extremely social. And so this generation may very well be the generation to start evolving that individualistic type paradigm, so to speak. So does that answer your question?
Somewhat.
Let me answer it better then. Tell me where I've missed the, I want to make sure that I'm addressing it appropriately.
It was just more so like, because I was wondering, because you say how like the Great Depression caused like some of the older generations to be less individualistic. So what I'm wondering is why is it then that the reverse effect happened when the economy went bad when we were younger?
Well, I'm not so sure that the older generations were less individualistic, but I do think that the older generations had different values and different beliefs. Like, for example, within the 60s and 50s, social justice, was definitely a paramount topic. So then during that time, you'll see law, if you research, and you'll see laws that were enacted around that time regarding equality, regarding rights, pay. So whenever you think about the context of whenever or when a generation grew up within, that kind of shapes those situations and scenarios within the work environment. So within this current era of millennials, we see a lot of the blurring, we see a lot of much more flexibility within organizations as opposed to those rigid structures that occurred in previous years. Yes,
ma'am. Yeah, and in the Great Depression, the kids that were growing up, in the Great Recession, us kids growing up, we weren't allowed to work. We had laws and whatnot to protect us from being worked. Back in the 1930s, when the Great Depression was going on, they were encouraged to go be part of a factory, be part of a cog wheel. They grew up with that because they had to.
That's right.
So by the time they got to be older and whatnot,
That's right.
That's just the way things work.
That's right. Absolutely. Excellent questions and excellent points. That's right. That's right. And we talked about this too. So those consequences of rigid structures, disengagement, feelings of being trapped. So these are things that we talked about, not meeting your potential or unable to discern your vocational purpose. And I know that, I think these notes will be available for you too, because I know some of you are writing some notes down. I'm trying to give you the opportunity to jot some items down too, but I'm aware of the time too. But we're having such great discussion. I love it. So look at this painting for me, this painting. So from a leader perspective, I'd like for you to answer this question. If this painting represented an employee landscape, how would you describe it? If this painting represented your employee base, as a leader within the organization, how would you describe your employee base? Just from this painting. Yes, sir.
Diverse.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, ma'am. Awesome. I didn't think of that. You went into the organization and went into units, and that's exactly right. That's another thing you'll see within organizations of today, how departments or units are no longer working in silos. Departments are trying to work together more and integrate, because systems theory, if you've heard of systems theory, shows how units and varied phenomena are interrelated. So yeah, that's awesome. So diversity, anything else? A rich, colorful, thick, look at the textures there, a rich employee base. So as a leader, what I'm helping you to do right now is to, from a different perspective, be mindful of how your employee landscape is, because that's what leaders are doing right now. They're practicing mindfulness. How would you appeal to the expectations of this rich, thick, and colorful employee base? What do you think you would do as a leader? Be accepting, which reminds me of a supportive leadership style. Be accepting, be caring, thoughtful. Yes, ma'am.
Take care not to do things that would allow the color to fade.
Absolutely. Oh, I love this group. Yes, I love that. Yes. And that is a part of that fluid landscape, that fluid organizational setting, where we want to ensure that our programs and our services and benefits are fluid, because we don't want to lose that color. We don't want to lose that rich experience. Yes, sir.
Offer equal opportunity. so all the employees to have opportunities to progress in their job growth experience?
Thank you. Inclusion. Exactly. So you said diversity earlier. Inclusion is so important too. And that's manifest within the school setting through those programs and through those services that we offer. And I'll tell you about one of them in a little bit. Yes, ma'am.
Allow movement of the colors into departments and blending them.
Yes. Exactly. And that actually is a great example of our career mobility program at the credit union, which is another service that we offer for our employees. Career coaching, an internal internship opportunity, because again, we want to be able to offer inclusive programs and services that maintain that rich and colorful environment. Oh, wonderful. Anything else? You guys are so impressive. Speaks a lot to this school and your professors, and it's outstanding. Wonderful. And I think we've answered this too, actually. How would you navigate this landscape? And I think we talked about that a little bit. And one of the things that I always advise individuals to do and leaders to do is to gain knowledge surrounding your employees. You know, just learn more about cultures. I'm actually working on a course right now within our credit union, a multiculturalism course, because with that knowledge, I know, with that knowledge of individuals and in context and their cultures, then we gain understanding, you know, and as we gain that understanding, we're able to improve our interactions with each other. So we talked a little bit about mindfulness. Anyone want to take a jab at what mindfulness is?
Think before you speak.
Yeah, definitely think before you speak. That's always right. What else? Anyone over here? In the back over there? Well, mindfulness can also be considered an awareness, a heightened awareness of some type of phenomenon or some type of event that's occurring. It's conscious awareness. And so remember when we talked about how leaders are being much more aware of what's going on within their environment? Leaders are practicing mindfulness, which, rewind years ago, that may not have been the case as much. And so at that intersection of mindfulness and business, leaders have the opportunity to learn more about their employees' needs. And not just employee needs, but human needs. Remember those challenges that we talked about earlier? And the challenges can be anything. You know, life goes on as we are in school or as we work. Organizations are being more mindful of these complex issues that individuals bring into organizations as well. And that may manifest in different ways, such as wellness, membership, like someone said, wanting to be included in different things. So ensuring that your programs and services have membership opportunities. Purpose, continuous development, we talked about that, empowerment. These are all things that organizations are being mindful of within the work environment. We talked a little bit about participative leadership style as well, where you're not just going to take direction, you would like to be involved within that decision-making process as well. And so you see how these different things appeal to different areas, such as your physical, spiritual, mental, and emotional. Employers are empowering their individuals more, empowering individuals to learn within their environment, and giving what's called experiential learning opportunities, giving you the opportunity to actually work within a chosen career field, or actually perform the work as you're learning it, also called action learning. Removal of barriers, and we'll talk a little bit about that in a few minutes, but clearing paths for individuals so that way they can really take advantage of the learning opportunities within the organization. So this is what 21st century organizations are looking like. And that mindfulness urges action, because if we have individuals or leaders who are being mindful without action, then we end up going back to those rigid structures, right? Let's see. Oh, so I'd like to show you a little video, because we talked a little bit about, or quite a bit, about the different things that go on within an organization. And so I'm kind of using South Carolina Federal as a case study with this, because I'd like to show you how a typical day may look for an individual within the credit union. So what do y'all think of that? What are some elements you've seen within that what'd I do? No, this is the surprise. That's for the end. So did you all see some of the things that we discussed in there? What are some elements that you see that we discussed?
People being wellness.
Yes. Yes, wellness.
Mm-hmm. Health, people moving, happy.
Happy, you know, wellness.
Smiling. Going to, being able to go different places in the building.
Absolutely. Yes, thank you.
Development.
Integrity coaching, yes. Yes. What else? Did you see the career coaching discussion? That's right. Did you see areas for social gathering? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, we actually invite vendors within the community in, and the question was, do we have our own chef? And we actually invite just different vendors within the community in, and we invite them in on different days. And that particular day, we have Sushi Friday. And so We try to make it simple for our employees where they don't necessarily have to go out if they don't want to go out and grab lunch. They can just stay within our employee common area and eat lunch, for example. Mm-hmm. And so everything that you've seen there was mindful decisions that were being made to implement those things, because we want to be able to acquire, engage, and retain employees, specifically millennials, who will represent the majority of the workplace over the next few years. Right now, 40% of our employees are millennials. When I did a couple studies at the organization, I was so surprised to see that. And so we're going right along that trajectory of having, within a couple of years, the majority of our employee base represent millennials, which I think is phenomenal. So I do want to tell you, spend a couple minutes just talking about the difference between a credit union and a bank, because I was surprised going out to some of the events within our community, whether it was career fairs or job fairs at different colleges and universities, and individuals weren't sure about what a credit union is. Now, actually, I know that you all have a credit union here on this campus, so that was very nice to see. But here's some information about credit unions that'll be helpful or that you may want to know, which I think is really good since you have a credit union here on campus, and this applies to all credit unions. And I'll focus on the top row there, profit and community involvement. Credit unions, they are non-for-profit, or we are non-for-profit. Our members, they own equal shares, so as opposed to a bank, which has stockholders. And so within credit unions, the money that we receive from our members is reinvested back into the credit union or within our communities, as opposed to a bank where the dividends go to the stockholders. Regarding the community involvement, South Carolina Federal, as I mentioned, we are really big on being a true active entity within our community that helps our community. And whether that's through financial services, education, budgeting 101, how to land a great job, whatever that is, we will reach thousands of people per year and provide educational courses for our individuals or for our members. So we take that very seriously. The services that we have at a credit union, especially ours in particular, some credit unions may not offer some services, but our credit union, being the largest credit union in South Carolina, over $1.4 billion in assets, we are able to offer the same services as a bank would offer. Mm-hmm. Any questions on credit unions at all? People helping people drives the movement for credit unions. It's the reasons why credit unions exist, to provide a financial service to individuals. And that underpinning continues to drive that movement even to this day. Let me share this with you too. As you can see there, the credit union movement, a collaborative effort to improve the quality of life for everyone, for our members, communities, and the society as a whole. And so we say the credit union is not an industry, but it's more of a movement because of that collaborative effort. And again, it's fluid and it's continuous. Here are some of the charities that we support. Well, actually, this one here with MUSC, where we gave over $10,000 to MUSC. And this is only one example that we have. If you visit our corporate social responsibility page, there are literally probably close to 50 different organizations on there that we support and we help, and we actually have a foundation. And this foundation contributes to several charities throughout the community, and our employees put dollars in, and the credit union matches that amount as well. So we're really, really big into corporate social responsibility. So services to others engages, motivates, and fulfills employees, thereby encouraging happier employees, just like we talked about. Happier employees. All of these things that we do are to ensure that we have, or we remain a competitor or an employer of choice amongst our competitors. Let's see. And so this here is a, and I'm looking at the time too. I wanna make sure we have time for some additional questions. But this video, it just literally covers a lot of what we just talked about. And so I just wanted to bring it in a different form. But I think because of time, what I'd like to do is just make sure we cover the rest of these slides as well. And I really want to give you the opportunity to see that video, which is pretty neat. We talked a little bit about employee development. As I mentioned, most organizations are taking their linear development, whether that's your online courses, and making it more dynamic. Making it more dynamic so that way it meets the needs of the employee base. So whether that's through coaching or whether that's through internship opportunities, whatever that is, we want to be able to capture and retain the interests of our employees through continuous development. Anyone ever heard of a learning organization? Yes, good. So South Carolina Federal Credit Union is a learning organization. We do believe in providing continuous development for our employees, and for not just development that meets our needs as an employer. Certainly it has to align with business objectives, but also we want to ensure those development opportunities actually help our employees, actually improve and help not only just the professional, but also the personal development of our employees too. So we're mindful of that. And just to tie this into theory, one of the things that we did, we tied it into our career development opportunities into Fink's taxonomy there, which, and I mentioned this briefly before, where acquisition of knowledge, augmentation of understanding, and application on the job really supports that learning process. And these are elements that we use within the credit union when developing our programs and services. They underpin the formation of our programs and services, as you'll see on the next slide. And I put this quote in here from one of my professors, Dr. Winston, where he says, "Facts become knowledge, knowledge becomes information, and information becomes wisdom," which is augmentation of understanding. Information becomes wisdom in the process of understanding, ever more increasing application, while ever more increasing in simplicity. And so to see this enacted within the work environment, here's a service that we have that I think you'll find interesting. And let me know if any of you have this within your current setting. So what we have within our credit union is a career mobility program. And this program gives individuals the opportunity to navigate, to move throughout the credit union. And it gives individuals to have the opportunity to experience an area or unit within the organization that they may not have had the opportunity to experience before. Now, this is a process that individuals go through, and there are layers underneath each area. You'll see there, first we validate eligibility. We want to ensure that they've done certain things such as training and been within the organization for a certain amount of time. Career coaching, that's when individuals have a discussion with me. I'm the only career coach within the credit union right now. And so I get the opportunity to talk with individuals about their career aspirations, talk with them about their current career experiences. Some individuals I talk with, they have no idea what they would like to do, and that's okay. Because what we can do is narrow that broad field and narrow it down. I have individuals doing values coding and they don't even know it. And what that means is if I have an individual who has interest in several different areas, I may have them review job descriptions and pull out those meaningful duties or those meaningful words that appeal to them, and that's how they begin to narrow that scope. Or if they have an interest within a particular area, then we'll begin to move down that line. But one of the things that I share with individuals is that this is their journey. And that's another change that is occurring within organizations. Whereas previously, organizations would really feed individuals development opportunities depending on where that organization needs to align that individual. But now, organizations are putting that responsibility on the employee. The employee is responsible for the career journey, and what employers are doing is ensuring that they provide individuals with tools and resources to help that individual along his or her journey. And so that's a big difference too. So that career coaching discussion is the beginning of the knowledge building, because the individual is beginning to discern what he or she would like to do. Research and discovery. I may have an individual go out and do research on different fields or areas. I may have them join an association, read a particular book of interest, because what I'd like for them to do now is continue to gain that knowledge, gain a good bit of knowledge, so that way when they move to the next step here of career path consultation with the department manager of interest, they can speak from a knowledgeable place. They may have questions that would have emerged during that time. And it's very likely that during this time, individuals begin to say, okay, well, maybe I don't want to go within this area, which is great because they've learned something new about themselves. During this area here, when having that discussion with a manager of interest, then they can learn the expectations of that manager as well and begin to ask deeper questions since they've built that knowledge. And here's where the individual augments that knowledge with increased understanding by doing observations in whatever area he or she would like to be in. They may watch that person perform that responsibility, and that's another way to build understanding. I also advise individuals to journal. I'm a big believer on journaling. Anyone journal here? Oh, yeah. It's really, I think it's a really good thing to do because we as humans, we tend to form meanings about any type of event or phenomena that we encounter. And we make these immediate interpretations. But when you sit down and you journal, that gives you the opportunity to dig deeper. You can make a conscious effort to gain increased understanding about whatever that activity was. And so it helps your learning process as well. And you begin to draw those connections, which is really important too. So I always advise people to journal because it helps in even discovering how you learn. Now, finally, we have the Blue Internship Program. And this is where we have individuals actually go within a department of interest and they work within a field that they would like to be in. And so that could be for a certain amount of hours per week or maybe per month, whatever that relationship contract is. And here's where I require managers to have our interns do meaningful work that will help the individual's development. So any questions on this here? I wanted to share this with you because hopefully more organizations will be having this type of learning and development and this type of process here, which really augments learning and really engages the employee as well. Yes, ma'am.
Work that helps their development. Is there non-meaningful
Very good question. Yes. So I require my managers to send me a job description because I want to make sure that they are giving individuals work that's important, work that is significant, work that is not just work to help meet their goals, not just administrative work. Not to say administrative work is not important, but we want to make sure that our managers are not giving individuals busy work. We want to ensure that managers are getting, like, for example, I have an intern. I'm about to get another intern, and both my interns are millennial, and I have them working with me. They're strategizing with me. They're doing research with me. They are going out and having interviews with people within the organization. We're doing studies together, meaningful work. I have a ton of administrative responsibility, too, that I'm actually working on. I probably need one of them to automate those processes for me, which is what we look forward to doing. But those are things that I'm not going to give it to them just because I hate to do it. I won't do that. I want them to be able to find just as much development out of this as possible. And something that'll help them make the decision, is this something I'd really like to do? Is this fulfilling for me? Do I see myself in this role? Should I continue to aspire to be within this role? So great question.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. What other questions? And I just wanted to show you this academic model we have within the organization. And I'll show you this School of Holistic Development. Remember I said organizations are being much more meaningful to an individual's needs? We have book clubs about spirituality. How do leaders and employees navigate a stressful environment? You know, it's a new norm. Organizations are operating under tighter constraints when it comes to resources, which means that people may be doing a bit more with less. There may be pressures that our employees or leaders are experiencing in meeting goals, which is a part of the operation. But how do we do that from a place of joy? How do we remain joyful? We have book clubs about spirituality, which is pretty cool. Like I said, multiculturalism, this is one that I'm currently working on. Ethics, you know? So these are the things that we're doing to not only have the practical here, but also to help develop individuals personally, too. So here are some recognitions, and I only show this to you because these awards here, they're based on our talent management, our career development, career services, things that we've done to help retain that employee base. And so ranked number 5 best places to work in South Carolina, we have Diversity and Inclusion Awards, and these are just a few. Training Professional of the Year, and ranked number 4 best credit unions to work for. And that's this is a national award here. And this is not why we do it, but it's nice to have these little recognitions. Yes?
How long has your South Carolina Federal Credit Union been earning those awards? Is this like their first time to show up in that award palette, or have they won one or more of those awards on multiple occasions?
Yes, we, especially within diversity and inclusion, I can speak intimately about that because I'm over diversity and inclusion within the credit union. As well. And so we've won a number of diversity and inclusion awards, a number of learning and development awards, best places to work, which pretty much our employees are through a third party agency are saying, you know, I really do love to work here. And so, yes, we have won a number of awards over the years. Mm-hmm. So I want to show you this fun video, and it's just a couple minutes, and then Before I do this, though, any questions? Because this is the last slide, and I know we're coming close to ending. Yes, ma'am.
Just real quick, could you tell them about your designations? I think you have
HR,
EHR, and SHRM-CP.
One, two, three. Sure, sure. It's through SHRM. I also have a PHR, which is a professional in human resources development. You have to have a certain amount of hours within the field in order to even apply for those types of certifications. And the way I keep up with those certifications is through continuous education. And it doesn't have to be formal within a classroom. What's great is even that the work I do within my job, it allows me to say, okay, I create things, I implement things within my job, and that helps with those recertifications as well. And so I have to remain current with it. So it urges and pretty much forces individuals who have these certifications to remain abreast of those the latest and the greatest, and even the employment laws and employer relations and things like that. So it's through the Society for Human Resource Management. I'm not sure if any of you have heard of the Society for Human Resource Management, but a very reputable organization who administers certifications. And these certifications just represent the amount of experience that the individual has. And most professions have some type of certification that is representative of that person's level of expertise. Any other questions? Okay, let me show you this fun video. I think you'll enjoy it. Oops. Okay, if I can get it to start. I think it's gonna start now.
Do you like to dance? You may. CEO, that is my CEO. Vice President of HR here.
Yeah.
sorry, my eyes are, I think my long day has just come down on me. My eyes got red all of a sudden. You're like, enough. Yeah, I don't know what else is coming up there. I'm not responsible for that. You know how YouTube is. Oh, and I just closed it up. But that was the that was the last slide. Any one of you are from South Carolina or will be traveling to South Carolina in the summer? Because you can call me up. Come visit South Carolina Federal. Well, guys, it has been an absolute pleasure. I appreciate it. I loved all the questions and the engagement. You guys are fantastic. Thank you for having me. Yeah. Take off all my wires now.